be it in the name of the living God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Welcome to this Ash Wednesday service of reflection, recorded here in the upper room of the St. James Centre, where in recent years we have gathered in the evening for a quieter, more contemplative service to mark this most special, most holy of days, beginning as it does the season of Lent, the 40 days which we often speak of as a springtime of the soul, as much as they are about self-examination. So also I think this is a season for growth in self-compassion. And that sense of the compassion and the mercy, the love of God, is always for me captured in the collect for Ash Wednesday. Though it's a collect which rightly recognises that we kind of just feel terrible when we lose our way and in doing so get caught up in sin. Yes, we feel pretty wretched. Actually, there is a God who longs to welcome us with love and to bring us a renewal of life. And for me, that is the heart of the season of Lent, journeying with self-compassion and self-examination to that point where we can truly celebrate the new life we have in the risen Christ. But now, as we sit wherever we are, let's pause and keep a moment of stillness as we offer the collect for Ash Wednesday. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all those who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthy lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Church moves into the season of Lent, reflecting on the third of our four characteristics, those things we feel to be, those values, those attitudes, foundational to the life of a renewed Church. And the third characteristic is freedom. We describe it this way: freedom, empowered by the joyful liberty we have in Christ. Harbour Churches, you and me, will set people free to build God's kingdom in their lives and the world around them, active in mission and evangelism. That phrase, joyful, glorious liberty, is taken from Paul's letter to the church in Rome, where he writes this in chapter 8, verse 19. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. The creation itself will be set free from its bondage of decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. In Christ we have a freedom in these coming Sundays, in this season of Lent. We can explore more deeply just what that freedom means in our lives of faith and what it might mean for us as a church community seeking to be good news and to build up God's kingdom. We tell a story, and it's a wonderful story, but like many stories we tell it knowing the end. We know what happens. We know what God in Christ has done for us. We celebrate, yes, the seasons, the various chapters, moments in the story, but essentially, friends, we are a people of the Pentecost. We are a people of the Spirit. When Paul wrote to the church in Rome through chapter 8, he explores the life of the Spirit we have in Christ. And he says this, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death." What might that Spirit of life in Christ mean? Well, I think for us it means a response to love. And that love is the love that is made real in Christ Jesus, the love of the God of love, who so loved the world that he gave us his only Son. There's a word we use often in this season of Lent. We used it in the collect. It comes from 17th verse of Psalm 51. "A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." The word is contrition. When we are contrite, we often think that we have a greater knowledge of how we have fallen short, and maybe a more pronounced sense of our wrongdoing and the associated feelings of guilt, and then, of course, the anticipation, which we all know and has for many of us been hardwired since our earliest days, of punishment, of being called to account for our wrongdoing and having to receive the penalty. But actually, the word contrition will mean at its heart that we are not responding out of a sense of guilt or of fear. That this is not a life of faith lived with a spectator God who is judging and assessing our each and every action to pronounce judgment upon us. But rather, this is the God of love, whose gaze upon us will only ever see how lovable we are. Yes, of course, it pains God's heart of love when he sees us living loveless lives and of inflicting on others that lack of love and of mercy. That happens, of course, when we lose our way, when we fall into the sin of putting ourselves first, of forgetting God's call to live lives for the sake of others, mirroring the life of Christ, which is a life of unconditional love. When someone loves us, our life is transformed. I hope and pray we've all had an opportunity to experience that loving which is unconditional and which is affirming of all that we are. A love that recognises how we do fall short. A love that says, "I know you're not everything, but you're everything to me." As we often say, a love that recognises that we are not perfect, but that we are forgiven. Contrition is a powerful spiritual practice. A living in the light of the love that God has for us. And how, living in that light, we can bring the light of God's love to others. This Lent, may our hope, our prayer be that we can practice that self-compassion. In the practice, yes, of self-examination, where we can see how so much of what we do, which is loveless and death-dealing, comes out of a lack of our own self-compassion, and recognizing that God truly loves us, and in his Son Jesus Christ, as we will come once again to discover, we pray, more deeply as we journey into Lent and Holy Week, gave his life as a witness to the power of that unconditional love. An unconditional love that no death dealing darkness or despotism can ever destroy. Chapter 8 of Paul's letter to the church in Rome, a church itself that had to live daily with the threat of that tyranny, that death dealing, and that despotism, and could so easily have responded in like manner. But that chapter 8 ends with these wonderful words. You'll have heard them before. I offer them to you as food for the journey in this season of Lent. Paul writes this: in all these things, the hardships, the sufferings, the wrongdoings, the muddles, the messes, the being me, the being you, that's quite annoying and we wish we weren't. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced, writes Paul, that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. May the power of that love be for you this Lent, a way to come to know more truly the God of love who in Christ Jesus loves each and every one of us so completely and longs for us to know just how much we are loved. From the ancient liturgies of the church, there is a simple song, a chant that has been offered. The words are so simple, they just speak again of that mercy. Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. In the Greek, Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. I'd like us to listen just to a minute or so of those words set to a Tese chant. A theologian, Olivier Clément, speaking of the worship of Tese, said that at its heart it has the power to wake up sleepwalking humanity. It does that through its measured beauty and the integrity of love, which is at the heart of the Tese community itself, a place created for the healing of hurting and broken humanity. Let's listen now to that chant, and then I'd like to invite you to join in with me the words of self-examination and confession from the service we would have had normally to mark this Ash Wednesday. They're powerful words, and we need to prepare ourselves for them, because they are words of self-examination. This season of Lent is not a time of cheap grace. We are going to have to look deeply within ourselves if we are to truly have that depth of self-compassion. Because remember, there is nothing within us that God's love cannot heal, cannot redeem, cannot make new. And we must not seek to hide anything from God or from ourselves.
Be there.
So, dear friends, let us now call to mind our sins. And in calling to mind our sin, the infinite mercy of God. God the Father, have mercy upon us. God the Son, have mercy upon us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy upon us. Holy, blessed and glorious Trinity, have mercy upon us. From all evil and mischief, from pride, vanity and hypocrisy, from envy, hatred and malice, and from all evil intent, good Lord, deliver us. From sloth, worldliness and love of money, from hardness of heart and contempt for your word and your laws, good Lord, deliver us. From sins of body and mind, from the deceits of the world, the flesh and the devil, good Lord, deliver us. In all times of sorrow, in all times of joy, in the hour of death and at the day of judgment, good Lord, deliver us. By the mystery of your holy incarnation, by your birth, childhood and obedience, by your baptism, fasting and temptation, good Lord, deliver us. By your ministry in word and work, by your mighty acts of power, and by your preaching of the kingdom, good Lord, deliver us. By your agony and trial, by your cross and passion, and by your precious death and burial, good Lord, deliver us. By your mighty resurrection, by your glorious ascension, and by your sending of the Holy Spirit, good Lord, deliver us. Give us true repentance. Forgive us our sins of negligence and ignorance and our deliberate sins. And grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit to amend our lives according to your holy word. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Make our hearts clean, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Let us pray. Father eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in what we have thought, in what we have said and done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us out from darkness to walk in the glorious liberty of your children of light. Amen. features of Ash Wednesday is the ashing, the imposition on ashes. Obviously, in these COVID times, it's quite hard to offer that. You can't be having lots of people putting thorns in ashes and spreading it on people's foreheads. But now I'd like just to ash myself. And as I do so, you might want just to touch your forehead and mark it with the sign of the cross. We do that because we recognize this time of self-examination, of self-compassion, is one that demands that we pray for God's strength and God's grace. This is something we can't do on our own, and indeed, we don't need to do it on our own. We do it in the strength of God's love revealed to us in the cross of Christ. Dear friends in Christ, I invite you to receive these ashes as a sign of a spirit of penitence with which we shall keep the season of Lent. God our Father, you create us from the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be for us a sign of penitence and a symbol of our mortality. For it is by your grace alone that we receive eternal life in Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. So may the Lord enrich you with his grace and nourish you with his blessing. The Lord defend you in trouble and keep you from all evil. The Lord accept your prayers and absolve you from all your offences for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. We end this time of marking the beginning of the season of Lent in sharing the peace, sharing it in the ways we have learnt, virtual, online, recorded, but still the peace reminding us that we are Christ's body, called to be Christ to the world. And through the depth of our self-examination and self-compassion to bring his good news, his healing, hope and peace. Dear friends, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Our service closes with the tune of a wonderful Easter hymn, but I want to hear it now. I want you to recall in your mind the words, because for me they are the the words of hope that we hold on to, that we are a people renewed daily through the work of God's Spirit, through his loving Christ, renewed daily into newness of life and called to bring that newness of